Penguin Audio presents Burning Bright, written by Tracy Chevalier, read by Jill Tanner. Part 1. March 1792. Chapter 1. There was something humiliating about waiting in a cart on a busy London street, with all your possessions stacked around you, on show to the curious public. Jem Kellaway sat by a tower of Windsor chairs his father had made for the family years ago, and watched aghast as passers-by openly inspected the cart's contents. He was not used to seeing so many strangers at once. The appearance of one in their Dorsetshire village would be an event discussed for days after, and to being so exposed to their attention and scrutiny. He hunkered back among the family belongings, trying to make himself less conspicuous. A wiry boy with a narrow face, deep-set blue eyes, and sandy fair hair that curled below his ears, Jem was not one to draw attention to himself, and people peered more often at his family's belongings than at him. A couple even stopped and handled items as if they were at a barrow, squeezing pears to see which was ripest. The woman fingering the hem of a nightdress that poked out of a split bag. The man picking up one of Thomas Kellaway's saws and testing its teeth for sharpness. Even when Jem shouted, "Hey!" he took his time setting it back down. Apart from the chairs, much of the cart was filled with the tools of Jem's father's trade. Wooden hoops, used to bend wood for the arms and backs of the Windsor chairs he specialised in, a dismantled lathe for turning chair legs, and a selection of saws, axes, chisels and augers. Indeed, Thomas Kellaway's tools took up so much room that the Kellaways had had to take turns walking alongside the cart for the week it took to get from Piddletrentide to London. The cart they had travelled in, driven by Mr. Smart, a local Piddle Valley man with an unexpected sense of adventure, was halted in front of Astley's Amphitheatre. Thomas Kellaway had had only a vague notion of where to find Philip Astley, and no idea of how big London really was, thinking he could stand in the middle of it and see the amphitheatre where Astley's circus performed the way he might back in Dorchester. Luckily for them, Astley's circus was well known in London, and they were quickly directed to the large building at the end of Westminster Bridge, with its round, peaked wooden roof and front entrance adorned with four columns. An enormous white flag flying from the top of the roof read "Astley's" in red on one side and "Amphitheatre" in black on the other. Ignoring the curious people on the street as best he could, Jem fixed his eyes instead on the nearby river, which Mr. Smart had decided to wander along. To see a bit of London, and on Westminster Bridge, which arched over the water and ran into the distant mass of square towers and spires of Westminster Abbey. None of the rivers Jem knew in Dorset, the Frome, the size of a country lane, the Piddle, a mere rivulet he could easily jump across, bore any resemblance to the Thames, a broad channel of rocking, choppy green-brown water pulled back and forth by the distant tide of the sea. Both river and bridge were clogged with traffic, boats on the Thames, carriages, carts, and pedestrians on the bridge. Jem had never seen so many people at once, even on market day in Dorchester, and was so distracted by the sight of so much movement that he could take in little detail. Though tempted to get down from the cart and join Mr. Smart at the water's edge, he didn't dare leave Maisie and his mother. Maisie Kellaway was gazing about in bewilderment and flapping a handkerchief at her face.
"Lord, it's hot for March," she said. "It weren't this hot back home, were it, Jem?"
"It'll be cooler tomorrow," Jem promised. Although Maisie was 2 years older than he, it often seemed to Jem that she was his younger sister, needing protection from the unpredictability of the world, though there was little of that in the Piddle Valley. His job would be harder here. Anne Kellaway was watching the river as Jem had, her eyes fixed on a boy pulling hard on the oars of a rowboat. A dog sat opposite him, panting in the heat. He was the boy's only cargo. Jem knew what his mother was thinking of as she followed the boy's progress. His brother Tommy, who had loved dogs and always had at least one from the village following him about. Tommy Kellaway had been a handsome boy with a tendency to daydream that baffled his parents. It was clear early on that he would never be a chairmaker, for he had no affinity for wood and what it could do, or any interest in the tools his father tried to teach him to use. He would let an auger come to a halt mid-turn, or a lathe spin slower and slower and stop as he gazed at the fire or into the middle distance, a trait he inherited from his father, but without the accompanying ability to get back to his work. Despite this essential uselessness, a trait Anne Kellaway would normally despise, his mother loved him more than her other children, though she could not have said why. Perhaps she felt he was more helpless and so needed her more. Certainly he was good company and made her laugh as no one else could. But her laughter had died the morning 6 weeks before, when she found him under the pear tree at the back of the Kellaway's garden. He must have climbed it in order to pick the one pear left, which had managed to cling on to its branch and hung just out of reach all winter, teasing them, even though they knew the cold would have ruined its taste. A branch had snapped, and he fell and broke his neck. A sharp pain pierced her chest whenever Anne Kellaway thought of him. She felt it now, watching the boy and the dog in the boat. Her first taste of London could not erase it. Chapter 2. Thomas Kellaway felt very small and timid as he passed between the tall columns outside the amphitheatre. He was a small, lean man with tightly curled hair, like the pelt of a terrier, cut close to his scalp. His presence made little impression on such a grand entrance. Stepping inside and leaving his family out in the street, he found the foyer dark and empty, though he could hear the pounding of hooves and the cracking of a whip through a doorway. Following the sounds, he entered the theatre itself, standing among rows of benches to gape at the performing ring, where several horses were trotting, their riders standing rather than sitting on the saddles. In the centre, a young man stood cracking a whip as he called out directions. Though he had seen them do the same at a show in Dorchester a month earlier, Thomas Kellaway still stared. If anything, it seemed even more astonishing that the riders could perform such a trick again. One time might be a lucky accident. Twice indicated real skill. Surrounding the stage, a wooden structure of boxes and a gallery had been built, with seats and places to stand. A huge three-tiered wagon wheel chandelier hung above it all, and the round roof, with open shutters high up, also let in light. Thomas Kellaway didn't watch the riders for long, for as he stood among the benches, a man approached and asked what he wanted.
"I be wanting to see Mr. Astley, sir, if you'll have me," Thomas Kellaway replied.
The man he was speaking to was Philip Astley's assistant manager. John Fox had a long moustache and heavy-lidded eyes, which he usually kept half-closed, only ever opening them wide at disasters, of which there had been and would be several in the course of Philip Astley's long run as a circus impresario. Thomas Kellaway's sudden appearance at the amphitheatre was not what John Fox would consider a disaster, and so he regarded the Dorset man without surprise and through drooping eyelids. He was used to people asking.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.